good morning.
Good morning,
We're going to get started. Respect everybody's time. Thanks so much for, joining us. I was riding up the elevator with Merrick and talking about how Friday is the new Monday. So we know there's a lot of competing activities today, so we're really excited that you could join us. I know it's been a really intense semester. You know, we had our accreditation site visit. And we're coming on the other side of that, at least at the exit interview, with a commendation on SLOs. And a combination for our SLO framework and resources for assessment. And this SLO Symposium is one of those. So this is the fourth year we've done our annual SLO Symposium, where we feature different speakers, local experts, in different areas of assessment. And with our unveiling track dat that's going to be coming, we're really excited to have Dr. Jarick, Janio here today. Luis is going to introduce. So I wanted to welcome you, and thank you for coming. I think others will join us, but it's going to have a good one.
Thank you. So again, thank you for joining us, and I think Jarick is going to give us a short and sweet introduction to track that and what they're doing in Santa Ana with it as well. So I think at the end of the day, hopefully you leave with a little bit more understanding of what to expect when we implement track that next semester. We will pilot it with the SLO facilitators this semester and go all out the following.
So by next semester, you mean fall?
Fall, meaning everyone will be assessing in the fall semester, yes. Say that again.
Everyone, we will start the assessment over again.
All faculty, part-time and full-time, will be assessing through track that fall semester. Okay. This semester, however, we will be piloting with the SLO facilitators. So Dr. Jarick Janio is the presenter today. I think a very cool guy, and I hope you enjoy him today.
Of course I do.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Good morning. Good morning, everyone. My name is Jarick Janio. I'm the SLO coordinator at Santa Ana College. Pleasure to be here. Thank you very much for inviting me. Yes, we did have the SLO symposium, and I think that's how we actually met. We are going to repeat the event in January next year. One thing, just so that you know, the session is being recorded, but I did make sure that it can be edited, right? So whatever happens, right. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for that. Let's see here. Yes, we've been working with SLOs at Santa Ana for quite some time. We have purchased track that 2 years ago. We didn't implement it until last year. So for the last 12 months, we've been first, just like the plan I think is here. For the fall semester, we were in this pilot stage. We had we really worked only with people who were willing and able to work with it. It was really on a voluntary basis. By the end of this semester, we would like to have 100% participation of the whole college. So the way I look at this presentation is I will talk about track that, but I think more importantly, before we even go into what it is that track that can or cannot do, what's more important is what you put in it. Because ultimately, really, track that is nothing but a tool, and it really is up to you, your understanding of what student learning outcomes do for you, what program learning outcomes are, what is the institution doing about student learning outcomes, you know, things of that nature. And all this needs to be documented, data needs to be generated, all of this information goes into track that we generate the reports, and that's how we address the issues of program review or accreditation. The bottom line is that we are really focused, and I hope I will make it clear in my presentation, we are focused on what it is that our students do, what it is that they are learning. It's not about track that, it's not about accreditation, it's about what it is that collectively we can do for our students. So first of all, one more thing. Please don't hesitate to interrupt me and ask at any given point, okay? I don't necessarily need to be talking all the time. Let's go over some of the definitions that I think by now you are familiar with the concept of SLOs, you know what student learning outcomes are. Outcomes is what we expect our students to leave with, what it is that students are going to be leaving with at the end of our course. For program, the same thing needs to be said about collection of courses that amount to a certificate, prerequisites, or a degree. And then eventually, it would be good to look at the college's mission statement, because we all would like to make sure that our students who leave our institutions have good writing skills, they are familiar with technology, they know what it means to live out there in the society, so there's the civic awareness part of it. And all these things put together is what it is that we do at the college. So again, first thinking needs to go into this, but once we are done, then we do certain assessments, we document what it is that we do. We put this information in track that, and through the generation of the report, we get a good picture of what it is that we are doing as an institution. So, the way this works is in track that, and I'm going to start with that with course planning, is that each course, and I apologize if you cannot see it clearly, I'll definitely try to describe what's going on here. We have the title of the course SLO, once it's identified, coupled with a method of assessment. And now, what needs to be said here, and again, if you're familiar with the concept of SLOs, then you probably know that each outcome really needs to be paired up with some kind of a method of assessment. In other words, my expectation here for this course is that students will be able to do certain thing. How am I going to know that they're doing it? That's the question for assessment. So once we identify the concept in question, what it is that students need to learn, we do need to pair it up with some kind of a method of assessment, the way to measure what it is that students are doing and to what extent they are successful. Does this make sense? So in chart that it's somewhat mechanical, but it's very predictable. Once you have an SLO, you have a student and learning outcome, you must pair it up with a method of assessment. Otherwise, you can see the red flags. They are there for a reason. They probably could have been green to make them nicer, but at least they keep you on your toes. So in other words, you have a method of assessment, you have an SLO, you have a method of assessment. If one of the components is missing, then the flag is going to tell you that. That's the idea. Then finally, after the method of assessment, we move to results, and that's the data part. So again, once we identify what it is that students need to learn, once we administer the test, we move on to some kind of a result, because the assessment is going to give you a certain number, quantity. You will develop an opinion, or you will have an idea of what it is that your students are doing. Now here, I think what I could say, could I please have something to erase the board?
Oh, yes.
Sorry. Bloom's taxonomy. Okay. Super, there we go. Are you familiar with Bloom's taxonomy?
Oh, yes.
Okay, good. As always, there is some criticism of the idea. The reason I like it, the reason I think it's a good tool, is because it makes us focus on what it is that SLOs need to represent, and it goes together with the Academic Senate publications, and I'll just put here Academic Senate so that we know we are kind of like staying on task with this. Bloom's taxonomy. From the very bottom, on the very bottom of the taxonomy, right, we have those, what we may call simple or perhaps not very sophisticated skills or description of things that our students could do. So things such as students will be able to list or name, identify, those are not really things that require a lot of cognitive ability, right? This is something that, what color is this? If this is something that you teach throughout the semester, then you may want to think, okay, really? That's all I expect of my students? So I think that the whole SLO movement is getting closer and closer to a broader definition of what Academic Senate publication that you should have a copy of calls those overarching ideas, overarching principles, overarching concepts that students are to acquire as a result of your teaching. So again, if you think of, you know, again, list the reasons for, you know, why World War II started in history class. Okay, well, those things you can probably teach in one class, you know, in, I don't know, 2 or 3 hours. You just write them on the board and ask students to memorize them, and the following week you're going to test them and you're done. So again, listing of the reasons is not really the best thing that you know, or this is, you know, we could do better than that when it comes to the development of those cognitive skills. So let's move back to the definition of what's overarching. The overarching concept is, you know, kind of like global view of the course, right? So listing is not really necessarily everything and anything that we want our students to do. So what else is there? Well, if you think of what SLOs indicate as far as what it is that students are able to do, and you match it with Bloom's taxonomy, then let's move a step further. So instead of just listing the reasons of why World War II started, let's look at the analysis or synthesis or your opinion, observations. That's a little bit more sophisticated, right? It's a more profound intellectual activity. If you have to look at the reasons and you group them together and you say, okay, well, this is what happened historically, this is why things happened the way they did. Alrighty. So that's sort of like the middle column of the Bloom's taxonomy, the middle levels here. The highest one, however, where I can really safely say, or perhaps with a greater degree of confidence, that this is really an overarching concept for the course, would be something that has to do with the actual application of the knowledge you have earned in the course. So, for example, just imagine if you were Winston Churchill during World War II, what would you do? See the difference? It's not listening. It's not an opinion. It's more like, you know, hey, buddy, you just learned. What are you going to do about it? That is really the challenge. Now, when it comes to definition, and you look again at the Academic Senate publication, could I please draw attention to the, I think it's the blue handout here?
The glossary.
On page 13 of the glossary, it's a nice blue color. On page 13, we have the definition of student learning outcomes. Okay? That's probably the longest definition in the whole glossary. I don't know, we can wonder why. Maybe it's just difficult, it was difficult for the authors to explain what the concept is anyway. But right in the middle, you see the concept of the overarching outcome, right? Overarching. And as I just discussed, you know, matching this concept with Bloom's taxonomy, it kind of makes sense that, you know, listing of the concepts is not really overarching enough. When you ask students to analyze, to synthesize, to just give feedback about what it is that they think, okay, maybe that's overarching more. But when you look at the concept of what it is, or you ask students to actually do something with the knowledge that they've learned, that they acquired in the course, then it's probably even more encompassing everything that happens in the course, because at that point, students really need to draw on knowledge of everything that has just been taught to them. The difficulty here, however, is that for faculty, when you sit there and you start thinking, okay, how overarching is overarching? You're going to write this SLO statement, give it to somebody else, and are you sure it's overarching enough? So you can have those discussions going back and forth a number of times. And there's always this, you know, sort of like difficult fine line between what it is that I think overarching is and what my colleagues may think, and my understanding after I've taught the course, and perhaps 2 or 3 weeks into the course, I'm looking at the statement saying, you know, maybe that's not enough. So as I train faculty, I always wonder, you know, like, how do I get to this overarching concept? And I really like this the Bloom taxonomy connection. However, the question still lingers: is this overarching enough, or how do I explain that it needs to be overarching? What does it really mean? And I tell you, in my professional communications, I received an email from a friend of mine who teaches psychology in southern Spain. They do have SLOs in Spain too. So I asked her, okay, there's in literature, there's a connection to the Bologna Accord and so forth. Okay, so I sent an email saying, you know, hey, what do you guys do about SLOs? So she writes back, she sent me 3 or 4 research papers from Europe. Excellent. And then she says, you know what? Yeah, we have those. It's just that we don't really call them SLOs. We call them competencies. And it just kind of like, you know, hit me, oh wow. Instead of trying to bend my head against the concept of what it means for you to devise an overarching concept that encompasses everything and anything that happens in the course, why don't I just tell you, hey, listen, stick to competencies. These are the things that your students need to take away from the course. All of a sudden, it all makes perfect sense to me. The second thought, however, was, okay, wait a minute here. If I, as a result of this communication, figured out that there is a synonym to SLO, it's a competency, wouldn't Academic Senate or, you know, other people who wrote this literature, why didn't they say anything about it? So very quickly, I reached for the glossary. Could you please look at page 4? There is a definition of word competency that they have. Page 4. It's in alphabetical order. Competency.
Page 4 of the glossary section.
Page 4 of the glossary. Some people already chuckle. Page 4.
In the glossary, in the middle.
Okay, so for those of you. Yeah, page 4. What's the definition of competency?
CSLO.
There we go. That's the idea. So again, all those problems with, you know, overarching concepts and Bloom's taxonomy and everything else that happened, things kind of like fell into place for me. I think I finally got it. Because competency, again, is not necessarily everything and anything that students do in the course, because there is so much stuff that I'm doing, but still addressing the competency, the skills that students need to take away from the course. And I think the idea here is that we all do it in different ways. See, I could be using a lot of visuals, you could be heavy on lecture, she would like to have students write a lot. Completely different pedagogical approaches leading yet to the same development of the same competency, the same skill. And that's the idea. So the question of, you know, how overarching the given SLO is effectively goes away. It just needs to be focused on the concept, competency, skill, you name it. But all of a sudden I felt I was free to look for other synonyms and just say, okay, why don't I just focus on teaching and not worry as much about the phrases that describe what it is that students are working with. Okay? Going back to track that, each SLO matched with method of assessment, results, and then action. Ultimately, what we would like to do is, once we know what it is that the students can do or should do at the end of the course, we assess what it is that they do. We come up with some kind of a action on the resulting from the assessment data. What that means is that our students are, and that was my second point that's just kind of like faded here, our students are receiving grades at the end of each course. However, and yeah, we do spend quite a bit of time talking about what it is that grades are. We are looking at GPA as a very, very good predictor of student success. That cannot be denied. Students who have high GPAs in high school in, you know, South Central LA or South Chicago, East LA, from low socioeconomic backgrounds, they will do fine in any school that they go after. They really will. So that's a very good predictor, and it should not be just discounted. But there is a big difference between grading as a measure of student success and SLOs. And let me just, if I could have attention on my board here for a second. What happens with grading is that, let's just say, and again, I'll try to be generic to fit everybody's course here. Let's just say that we have two distinct SLOs in our courses. One has something to do with theory, and the other one has something to do with practice. Okay. If a student walks away from the course with a grade of B, what does that grade tell you? How good the student has, how well the student has mastered practice versus theory, right? We have those students who are very good in practice, very poor in theory, or the other way around, okay? And that's the problem, because pretty much, well, I don't want to say every single paper, but scholarly literature, people who spend time at universities studying the concept of SLOs, whenever they get to write a paper about SLOs, one of the first issues that they bring up to everybody's attention is that the reasons behind SLO movement, if we can call it a movement, outcome-based education, comes from the perspective that employers out there, people who actually pay our students to do jobs, complain or express concern about the skills that our students are taking away from our institutions. That's the problem. And SLOs will address that question. They really do. Because again, student will come out with, you know, a degree in computer science, very high GPA, perfect resume, goes, shows up to work, and what happens? Do you mind writing a report about what it is that you do, because I really need to have someone else to know? Right? Come again? Okay, why don't you just go ahead and, you know, just stand in front of a group of people and present it? Computer science engineer, present what? But this is what our employers really need. It's not just for you to sit there and do single task, no matter how complex. There are other things that you need to be doing. You need to be a team leader. You need to make sure that you know how to motivate people. You need to solve problems, thinking on your feet. All these things, if we are only focused on content of our course, will never be addressed or are rarely addressed. And again, that's a concern that over the years has been heard louder and louder.
What I find in my classes, I just don't have time. I have such a limited amount of time. I have to just deal with basics. And they, years and years ago, we actually had 4.5 months in a semester. They've cut it to now 4 months to a semester. So there's not a lot of time to deal with a lot of the other
very
things. That
that's right, that's right. Very, very good question, very good question. Again, if I could perhaps refer you to address that back to Bloom's taxonomy. If you think that you have enough time to simply put a list of notions for students to remember, okay, then we are done. That's it. However, if you were to incorporate that list of concepts that students need to remember, put it together for a small group, and I'm really just imagining how you could do it if I were to speak of a list, and let's just say that different people will be responsible for different parts of that list, And then you're going to remember five concepts, you're going to remember five, you're going to remember five. Then you're going to flip the pages over, you're going to recreate it together. Then at some point, you're going to see that certain parts are missing. Based on the context of from which this list originated, it will be up to you to figure out, to fill out the gaps. And perhaps, again, the instructor would be leading the discussion. But the idea is that, you know, instead of just me talking to you, I would, and instead of just, you know, giving you a piece of paper, please remember it by next Thursday, let's make it a classroom activity that's focused on the context of the discussion rather than just you got to do it because the teacher tells that. I'm not sure if you're familiar with the concept of flipped classroom. That's, again, it's a fairly new idea. And like everything else, you know, there's some positive and negative parts to it. But the idea is to flip the order in which things happen in the traditional classroom. So as you've gone through your, you know, BA master's degree programs, you might have seen that, well, you've experienced that. The teacher would tell you, you know, here's your textbook. He can edit it. It's okay.
That's an SLO.
The teacher would give you a textbook at the end of the lecture and just say, okay, chapter 4, by next Thursday, there is going to be a test. Okay, so you just took notes from the lecture. Then you go home, you read the textbook, and next time around, you go back to the classroom and you try to answer a question, you know, based on the lecture and the reading. The idea behind flipped classroom is that you go, you pretty much do homework in the classroom. See, in order for you to do that, you have to come prepared, and that's the challenge. So students who are ready to participate in the discussion, they will come in and they will be the leaders. It's for you to figure out who those leaders are so that the issue of, you know, well, hey, I didn't have enough to eat, or I didn't have enough sleep, or just, you know, last night we just had somebody's birthday party, and sorry, I didn't get to those basic things, therefore I cannot participate. Those students who are ready are going to be leading the work in the classroom versus dropping it only on the student alone, go home and read and do just the best that you can, come back and I'll give you a test.
So it's bringing in inquiry-based collaborative learning rather than dispensing of content. Yeah.
That's exactly right. Mm-hmm. That's exactly right. Instead of just, you know, yeah, me talking about this, it's for students to discover and learn in the process how to interact with others, how to read, how to write, how to communicate, how to present. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. I think you sure? You'll be okay? Because you're a fraction second.
I just want to go farther down the line. Let's say there are a lot of courses using interventions like the flipped classroom approach. How do we maximize that and track that? So if we encourage folks, okay, document this strategy, put it and track that, what can track that do, or how can we maximize through track that to ensure that, I guess, more classes are utilizing the flipped classroom, like other interventions that we're using here?
Sure. That's, very, very good question. What happens is that it is important for faculty to realize that, and track that will help you. The idea here is that you are going to, I don't know if I specifically have that screenshot, but there is a way for you in TrackDub to identify SLO, couple it with a method of assessment, and then say what it is that this assessment really is, what it did, and how you achieved the results the way you did. There is a big expandable notes field in which you can describe everything to your heart's content. And the reason for that is that when you press at the end of the day the magic button to generate the report about what it is that, how to find out how your students are doing, you are going to have the column that I'll show you, the screenshot of how that works, how that's displayed, that's going to exactly tell you what happened. And then see, 6 months later, a year later, 2 years later, you're going to say, hey, yes, okay, look, this is what we did back in 2016, okay? so that you don't rely on those, you know, voices at the end of the room, you know, hey, I've been here for the last 27 years, I know exactly what works, you know. This is what we did, so let's revisit this. And if this concept didn't work for us, then let's give it up, let's do something else. If it did work, well, hey, that's to our credit. We invented it, we perpetuated it. It works for us, let's keep going. Your question.
Sometimes it just seems like if you have a positive experience over a period of 30 or 40 years and you get good results, sometimes it just feels like some of the, how can I explain it, some new ideas might not work as well as something that has been proven over 30 or 40 years.
Mm-hmm.
And in the arts, the music and dance and fine art, some of these don't seem to be relevant to flipping. And most of my information is given to the students simply from lecture. There's not really a book. There's not really. So if the students miss the lecture, they're up the creek.
Okay. So just to the very last statement you just made, I agree with everything you said except for the last part. I don't know if it's really, you know, you can always put it on the student, or at least let me see here. When I was at school, and I think I was a responsible student, not always with best of results, but I took school, you know, kind of seriously. And I think I would follow up and just kind of like ask my peers, you know, hey, if I missed the class, you know, what happened? I think it would be a good idea to, instead of just saying that students up the creek, just kind of like, you know, hey, here's what we do in case you miss it. You know, so there is this positive expectation that there is a support that's built in the classroom structure. So that's for you to figure out, and it really is. Yeah, and I think I just stole my punchline from the story joke I was about to say. Do you remember the movie City Slickers? Anyone? Do you remember there's this, you know, the concept was, who was it, Billy Crystal? Okay, so he's the guy, he's, you know, the guy who lives in New York City, and he goes to Texas for a couple of weeks of cattle chasing, you know. And in one of the scenes in the movie, he's riding next to this old cowboy who's done it for generations, and you know, he's Billy Crystal, you know, hey, I'm just, you know, look what I do, what, you know, so I come to you finding the meaning of life, you know, what's the story? What is there for me to do? What matters in life? And the cowboy, you know, it's a movie, so he doesn't even miss a heartbeat, you know, there's only one thing that matters in life. Only one thing.
First he says your finger. But then he says,
did he say?
Billy Crystal said your finger?
Right? Oh, that's right. Yeah, he's asking, well, okay. So your finger. There's only one thing that matters in life, and that's for you to figure out. So in other words, if you feel that lecture is what you do best and your students thrive on it, I'll be the last person to tell you anything different. It really is up to you to make sense. However, please be mindful that grade B is not going to tell us everything and anything that we know about what it is that your students are taking out of the class. And since I'm at it, again, when we have one SLO that has to do with practice and one SLO that has to do with theory, please make sure that in your course, you do everything and anything you can think of, and, you know, again, you're the faculty of record. It's absolutely your purview. Make sure that these things are addressed so that you can safely say that the students on the assessment reflective of these skills, of these competencies under those two umbrellas are performing well. And you can name it, you know, 70%, 80%, whatever it is.
But doesn't one affect the other? Doesn't theory affect practice and practice?
It's for you to answer.
Yeah.
That's your course.
Right.
You have, we have, at Santa Ana College, we have American Sign Language. Okay. One SLO for the course, SLO, you know, American Sign Language 101. One has to do with the ability for students to communicate using sign language. And the other SLO has to do with the culture of deafness. Is that a good example?
Yeah, that's a very good example.
Okay, so that's how I look at it. So obviously one is going to, you know, influence the other, but you can probably make a course out of, you know, just using sign language for all kinds of different reasons, and you can make a course out of, you know, cultural deafness, right? Mm-hmm. That's the idea. That's the idea. Okay?
Luis, thank you.
Okay. Well, just when I thought we were kind of like, you know, what time is it? We are fine. Curriculum mapping. Why is that important? Because, as I mentioned at the beginning, on the top of student learning outcomes, we talk about program learning outcomes, institutional learning outcomes, and all these concepts are somewhat linked and connected. So it is our job to figure out what the connection is. As I was saying earlier, regardless of what it is that you teach in the course, institution as a whole, and when you think about it for a good reason, you're part of it, you're just one of the components of it. Our students really need to be leaving our colleges knowing how to solve problems, you know, how to write, how to communicate, how to, you know, what it means to use technology. So all these things could be, should be, need to be incorporated in your curricula, in your respective areas of practice. And that's what curriculum mapping does. Curriculum mapping is a concept of pretty much a discussion. It's a process in which you're going to identify resources that you need to teach the given course. You're going to look at the student population that you serve so that the curriculum addresses the needs of the students who are coming to your classrooms. Obviously, if you have students who are not speaking English, you're aware of the resources of the teacher. So this is going to matter. Then you're going to look at the results of what it is that you taught and to what extent students got it. Okay, that's very important for you to know, because from semester to semester, you may have to be changing your curriculum to address those results. So we have certain materials, we have certain human resources available to teach the course. Let's just say it's the faculty of record. We have the library, we have the counselors, we have the instruction assistant. All these things put together, and our students, you know, you give them a test overall for the course. The success rate for practice SLO is 63%. Something to think about. So what you do is you sit around together with the department, with people who have, you know, vested interest in improving that record, and you come up with ideas saying, such as, okay, we need to have perhaps a couple more books would help in the library, or simply more books. Maybe we need to extend the lab hours. Maybe we need to have one more full-time faculty. Maybe we need to have more, fewer sections of the same course. Things of that nature. And the reason you do those, you have those discussions, is that, again, you can document them in track that, and at the end of the day, press the magic button, generate the report, and the report is going to say, okay, as a result of our discussions, this is what happened. Our students need to be learning this. This is how we know that they are learning this. And look, the result is just absolutely dismal. 63% is nothing to write home about. Okay, we are not happy with this. Let's go ahead and figure out an intervention, an action, some kind of a plan that is going to help us address this. Because now, we know that the SLO that has something to do with the practical part of the course, we are just not doing a good job. Let's look at the theory. You look at the SLO, the assessment, the result, and our students are performing at 85%. Is that okay? What if it's 95%? What if it's 98%? What would you do then? Sorry? No, there is an SLO that has something to do with the theory of the course, right? Philosophy comes to mind, obviously. Just one thing. Think about the other thing you do. What would you do if, I'll get back to you in just a second. What would you do if your students are passing this SLO at 98%? Are you happy with that result?
No.
What are you
going
to do?
Well, I would share what's going on with that high level of success.
That's right. That's right. So that's again, when you have the department meeting, you may want to think about what it is that the students already bring you to the classroom. Who knows? Maybe some kind of a pretest could be instituted as a matter of fact. Because you may be walking around the classroom thinking, whoa, I'm such a cool teacher. I mean, look, I taught them all these things throughout the semester. 98% cannot be any better, right? I mean, 2%, I can, you know, those there's always going to be 2%. So I'm doing very, very, very well. Well, but then when you look at the placement and where it is that the students are coming from, you will realize that, you know, hey, they just had two or three courses exactly on the same topic from three different teachers. You know, they come to your class just for the practical aspect of it. So then you want to think about, you know, how to revise the program. That's why, again, the program learning outcomes and curriculum mapping will come into play. Because you, in track that again, you will be able to identify the SLOs that align to a certain result. And if that result is not met, you will clearly see the gaps. And that is going to address that issue of students who are doing much better than we thought they would, and for what reason. Sorry.
I hate to keep slowing this.
No, 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 no. I mean, that's, you know... Again, it's for us, it matters.
I have these ridiculous questions. We have, to be totally honest, we have majority adjunct instructors that drive in, park their car, walk across campus, teach their class, get back in their car, go to the next school. Mm-hmm. It would be wonderful if the administration could somehow get these adjuncts together to work together, as opposed to just being these individuals that come to do this job for 2 hours or
right.
4 hours.
Right.
I don't know the solution to that.
Sure. Well, let me see here. Do you think that This is an aberrational situation that only West LA College is impacted by this?
Not.
Oh, it's not. Okay, alrighty. Well, so who else do you think could be impacted by this? Every single college out there, if not in California, in the whole country, asks the same question. So there, and however, just you know, to make sure that this is not completely you know, exercising futility to ask it. Again, when you look at track that and how SLOs are documented there, you may at some point indicate that the success of this skill in this course depends on what it is that adjuncts do. Now, as a department, what in the world can we possibly do to address this? And who knows, maybe you'll be the first one in the state who is going to find a solution to that, you know, a good question to that question. Good answer to the question, because the bottom line is that if that matters to you, that's part of this results discussion, and you should bring it up. It's just that, you know, the idea here is that you can clearly see what it is that your students can do, how successful they are. You will see how successful your institution is, what it is that you do. But I wouldn't necessarily thrive at this idea that once I have 65%, well, that's all I can do because everything else, the success of this course depends on the adjuncts, and there's nothing you can do about adjuncts.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's not where we need to have this discussion to be leading us. The idea is that, you know, okay, if adjuncts need to be engaged, well, let's request $1,500 per semester for, I don't know, whole, you know, weekend retreat, talk to administrators and find out if that's a viable solution. Utilize technology. At Santa Ana College, we have one of the music faculty, actually, out of all places. Not a computer science engineer, but music. He devised this, you know, Google spreadsheets or whatever, sends an email to the adjuncts All they have to do is answer 5 questions, click the submit button, and it all lands in his spreadsheet, and it's all aggregated, ready to go. Something to think about. And I'm not necessarily saying that that has to be your field, but perhaps there are others who know more about this. So again, collectively, we can figure out a lot of things. We just have to put our minds to it. And again, TrackDot is going to help you with this. Because again, it's very, very predictable. It goes from SLO to the method of assessment to the specific result. Right away, you're going to see what's the difference between practice and theory. The achievement rate for practice is 65%, for theory is 98%. What are you going to do as a department? And then you can go ahead and shoot all those questions and ask people, you know, that, yeah, questions that supposedly delay the discussion. That's not the point. It's for us to come to us out.
Thank you.
Okay? So that's curriculum mapping. And everybody has an idea of what it means? That we kind of like align things together in a discussion. It's a process. It's something for us to do collectively together. And I tell you, just sort of like a, maybe this is a practical tip, what you could do is have TrackDot displayed on a device such as this one so that everybody can see it. And collectively, you sit around and you figure out, okay, let's pay attention to this. Okay, let's just type it in. Save it, and at the end of the meeting, immediately spit out the report for everybody to have, to share. And then you're going to know that, you know, hey, this is done. Versus, you know, why don't you take notes, you know, and then send them to me, and I will, you know, do edits, and then we'll send them back, because that's what's happening. Again, there is probably nothing wrong with that system per se, except it's prone to error and subjective. If we all collectively agree that this is what we need to do as a result of our collective analysis of the data that we get from assessments, that's quite different than just asking for ideas and just kind of like, you know, putting them in a short 1 or 2 or 3 or 15 page report. Ready? So that's where we are. Let's move on to the next slide. And this is just the screenshot from TrackDot that shows you how curriculum mapping works. It really doesn't, because I don't want to kind of like impose our system on yours, but the idea here is that I do have the alignment of program learning outcomes to institutional, the student learning outcomes to program learning outcomes, and on the bottom I have the curriculum mapping. So again, each one of those activities can be done sort of like in real time in front of everybody. So it's probably the easiest and most effective way of really sharing the information with everybody who is involved there. So TrackDot can do it, and I think it really helps meaningful discussion. TrackDot and institutional learning outcomes. The reason I put this slide here was because, again, of the importance of keeping the bigger picture in mind. So again, I think your question about adjuncts is something that, you know, again, collectively we've experienced for years. It's an issue that's very much alive. It's just that when you think about it, you haven't heard of that at all.
No, it's not accurate. It's not, nothing to do with the adjunct program. We both work
right. See,
no.
And the reason
the
I bring
is not correct.
Well, let me just say that, you know, again, this is not an isolated concern, and I agree. Perhaps from the adjunct's perspective, the take on the situation could be quite different.
Yeah.
Yet, when you think about it, again, the whole discussion of One more anecdote here that I could probably tell you from this is real life. At some point, I started attending department meetings for all kinds of different reasons. And at some point, I realized, okay, how much time do we actually spend during department meetings talking about student learning? Go ahead and do it. My point exactly. We talk about textbook selection, We talk about, you know, lack of instructional assistants, lack of full-time faculty, about the administrator's decision, office politics, whose birthday is going to be next month. And when it comes to any one of these issues, it's kind of like an almost afterthought. Or in our collective conscience, we think it's implied or it's embedded in the department meetings. And in reality, month after month after month, year after year pass. And what do we have to show for that? Best practices that never get out. Attitudes that come from agiles that are never voiced. And all these things that, again, collectively we could do for the betterment of our departments, of our institution, without really leaving our isolated minds. I think that's a challenge. So thank you for bringing this up. I couldn't agree more. Where are we? College mission statement, okay. Alignment of the mission to programs. I think I already mentioned that more than once, that we have to, you know, we start with the course level outcomes, we go to program level outcomes, we align everything with institutions. So again, just if I were to describe, course will have to do with specific competencies that students need to take away from the course. Program would be competencies, abilities, concepts that students need to be familiar with, that, again, they should show some kind of a mastery of, as a result of a series of courses. So it's not just one course, but a specific sequence of courses that students are expected to complete within a certain period of time. When it comes to institution, that's why I put the mission statement on the top, because again, when you look at the mission statement and you kind of like think about it every single day before you say good morning to your class, you can probably see even the changes, what it is that you do. Because again, instead of just telling them in a lecture form, perhaps there is something you can do to elicit some kind of a production or response that really will tell you that students are engaged in what it is that you're doing, rather than just, you know, polite nodding of their heads. You know, that's exactly what it is. The reports, I think I alluded to this, and I may have a slide or two that will show you how reports work in track that. Resource allocation. I'm not sure if I exactly made it clear up to this point, but it is important. That again, track that is going to help you with those discussions from SLO to assessment to result. Okay. Then we have the analysis of the result, and we come up with some kind of a action plan. And that action plan, for the most part, is going to cost either money or curricular intervention or rescheduling or I don't know what else, but there are all kinds of different ideas to address the gap in practice and the achievement of students in when it comes to theory and in the given course. Okay? So track that again is going to address this. You will see in the report from SLO to method of assessment to result. You will have some kind of an action plan, and that ultimately should be linked to your specific resource allocation request. And the reason this is important is because, again, it's based on data. It's based on assessments that you, as faculty of record, devised, and you know in your professional judgment that those assessments work. Once you have that information, then you look at the results, you analyze them, and then that's when you figure out how much it's going to cost to improve your program. College-wide engagement, again, that's why I started the discussion with the mission statement, so that we know that from the president's top down, everybody is going to be involved in the process. And I tell you, there is, at the state level, Institutional Effectiveness Partnership Initiative, IEPI. I'm not sure if you've heard of it, but this may be for, you know, people who are coordinators. And one of the things that the IEPI does is that they come up with resource RPT, resource partnership teams, and these are people who have expertise in certain areas. And I serve on one of those teams, and the way this works is that the team goes to a college that requests help. And so we go, as if, you know, there's five or six of us on a team, we go and we talk to the president, we talk to the academic senate, we talk to the unions, we talk to classified staff, everybody across the board. And I tell you, one thing that becomes very, very, very obvious as you talk to people who represent the organization, the culture of the institution is everything. Nothing else matters. Really, no matter how bright the minds are, no matter what solutions you come up with, no matter what it is that guides your discussion, ultimately the culture, the interaction between people who run the organization is what matters. So track that is going to, again, inform the discussion, but by no means am I here to tell you that it's going to fix the problems for you. It is all, again, entirely up to you to figure out. Okay? Let's move on to the next one. ACCG C standards. This is something that just, again, it's a time-consuming challenge, and it's still a challenge in track that. Because as of January this year, ACCGC, you know, our accrediting body, is asking us to disaggregate and analyze learning outcomes and achievement data for subpopulations of students. You might be familiar with equity efforts, right, in the state. Are you getting a lot of equity money these days? So you've heard of that?
Mm-hmm. We've heard of it.
Yes.
You've heard of it, okay. The idea is that you identify certain groups of students who are underrepresented as a result of our instruction. Again, as I mentioned earlier, the culture. So let's just say that in practice overall, 65% of the students are not doing well, 98% of students are doing very well in theory. The idea here is that if you were to disaggregate the data for certain groups of students, and let's just say, I don't know, students who come from foster homes, and they are 30 years or older, their practice is not 65%, it's 42. Okay, something to think about. When it comes to theory, for the same students, it's not 98% at all, it's more like 71. Okay, that's the idea. That you disaggregate the data that's given to you and you look at certain populations of the students and you see how those groups compare to the representative group. Okay. Why does it matter for SLOs? Well, I think I just explained that the course consists not only of number of competencies that need to be acquired, but those competencies, you know, as college credit instruction is based on time spent in the classroom, right? We all operate on the 16-week intervals. And on the first day of the semester, this clock starts ticking and students start running, and at the end, you know, the stopwatch is stopped, and wherever you are, well, that's your grade, you're done, whatever you have, you know, accomplished in this period of time. Then you look again at how different subpopulations of students that you have identified, how they perform within the same time frame. That information, again, is going to tell you what it is that you need to do. Now, it is up to you, again, to figure out what it is that you are going to actually do, but at least you will know what the focal areas are. And that's really the idea behind desegregation of data for the subpopulations. ACCGC standard does not tell you that you have to do it for group X, Y, and Z. I think they still would like you to, well, in your case, in our case, I guess, we could follow the money and just say, you know, hey, whatever the equity groups are, we could do the same thing for SLOs. Oh, that makes sense, I guess. However, ACCGC doesn't say that you cannot do it in any different way. So again, if all of a sudden you feel that, you know, students are not doing, maybe you have huge ESL population, you know, or I don't know what else, or just, you know, students are just not exhibiting enough math skills or technology, you know, things of that nature. So you can, you're at liberty to, again, look at the data and identify the groups according to what it is that you feel you need in order to address the needs of those populations better. So but ACCGC standard is out there. Travel is going to help you. There is a data tools. Feature, and that's going to help you. I put in my presentation, and you have a copy, right? So those two links lead you to specific tutorials on that. So you can go for the newest version of track that that will show you how to use those tools. But the idea is that you can, and there's a couple of examples here. You can institute measures, and you can in track that you can. It's a very very nice feature. You can actually send a link to a survey or some kind of a assessment that is going to land in your mailbox. You're going to click on the link and go straight into this and work on it. So it's a good feature. At Santa Ana College, we do have course facilitators. Some divisions, some programs are much larger than others. If it's a program department of one, that's not a problem. But if you have, math or English, modern languages and whatnot, where there's, you know, really a lot of people involved, a lot of faculty and a lot of adjuncts, then again, track that is going to help you kind of like divide the groups into smaller subgroups, and you can assign work that way. But we do have course facilitators who are responsible for making sure that SLOs are identified correctly, that the methods of assessment are done. And then, again, the idea is that if it's a group effort, there isn't one person who is responsible for the work, and then nobody else knows what's going on. Yeah?
Yes, I'm really concerned about one particular theory. You just made mention of ACCGC standards. Mm-hmm. Why is it that these standards does not have the ability to have students to take classes in terms of having a mandatory standard for students to take a course. To make a course to be mandatory.
Mandatory?
Yes. What is it that the standard has softened?
Okay, that students are supposed to be taking?
Like for a course, for instance, we have a very important course.
Okay,
you
know,
counseling. Or personal development.
That is required, right?
It's required. But most students, we cannot make it mandatory. Mm-hmm. This system does not allow us to do that.
Yeah.
Why is it so?
Oh gosh. There's probably, you know, there's a lot of reasons or the ways in which I could address this, and I tell you, I don't claim to know everything and anything about policy, because again, this would come from the state level if this were to be a heavy-handed approach. But I think it all is set in the provisions of academic freedom, that we can pretty much do whatever it is that we want in the classrooms. And mandating someone to go into your class versus mandating someone to go into your class, you know, that calls for all kinds of different interpretations of what it is that you versus you, what it is that you do in the class. So for example, if we set up a guideline that you may not enter chemistry class unless you take a placement test. Okay, placement test is something that we can say is somewhat impartial. or let's just say that, you know, well, sure, students who take tests in the morning versus students who take in the evening, we can talk about the differences there. But the content of your class and your class may be quite different, and mandating it to that extent, I don't know if that's something, that's the route that we want to go, simply because, you know, again, we are dealing with human beings, and if students come in and they don't like your class for whatever reason, and they like his class, you know, it's all kinds of different things that come into play.
Let me clarify for you. Go ahead, Chuck. It's not about the two different instructors. He's talking about for its reality. The universities require introduction of college classes, or you don't get to register.
Uh-huh.
So we're wondering why, in the community college setting,
we don't have the same similar.
Why they are not required to take? Yeah. Our classes are called counseling now, introduction
right.
to college, because
right.
we know that it makes the difference of a student being more successful. However, we can't say that it's mandatory.
Okay, excellent. Okay, I think I got it. Thank you so much. Again. If you want to do it, and I don't know how it exactly works in the community colleges as a system versus Cal State or UC system, okay? However, if that's a concern for you, I would, by golly, bring it up to the administrator's attention and see what can be done at the college level. That's the best answer I can give you. So in other words, I cannot tell you that, you know, ACCGC should or shouldn't. I'm not going to make any judgments about what it is that they require as an accrediting body, because they are overseen by, you know, federal government and other agencies that look at what it is that accrediting bodies do. That's not really even part of this discussion. I think if you're concerned with it, what I would do is, again, look at how this works at the local level. Talk to the administrators and see how it can be addressed at this college.
Is the system not flawed in terms of conception and design? If we have this, if we are here today to talk about student learning outcome,
uh-huh.
and we talk about equity,
right.
students have to learn, students have to succeed.
Sure.
But we don't, they say you cannot force, I don't know how to say it again. I think we take it to the administration.
Sure.
Well, I would add too that that's the beauty of this system, of the SLO system, is that you can voice these recommendations. That's what this is all about, that we're sharing what works and that we voice the importance of these best practices. So we take this opportunity through track that or through the PDF system we have now, and we narrate why this counseling course is so important. What is the magical thing about it? Why should we institutionalize it and perhaps not call it mandatory, but put great emphasis on the high encouragement for our student body. But we use this process here to narrate that voice, to give it substance and to give it power.
Absolutely. That's the perfect answer. You do it at the local level. So you sit down with your department, with your area, and you figure out and you say, okay, it's gotta happen. Look. And again, track that is going to help you look at the data. You can bring all kinds of data. That's the idea. That you bring information to the table and say, you know, look, this is the success of students without the course, this is the success of students with the course. Which one do you want to do? Sorry.
You know, I've thought about this sort of question before, mm-hmm. because we have so many interventions going on, great interventions going on at West as we speak. And I think they're just inevitably correlated with teaching and learning. And so I want to be able to hone in better, more effectively, and hopefully track that is the mechanism that lends that opportunity, but to ensure that all these great interventions and learning strategies are documented and shared, more importantly.
That's right. That's the idea, absolutely.
So, related back to this, is there a way to actually chain courses? So like if there's a student population that took, let's say, you know, this course, to see if they are actually succeeding in the next course.
See, that's exactly what, that's right. Very good that you asked that. Because again, just if I could please have your attention for just a moment. I started the whole discussion with the issue of grading and how it is, it's not that it's a flawed system, but it doesn't give you all the information that's there. You know what comes into the composition of the grade, right? There was, you know, remember March 15th, there was a Friday, and you were supposed to bring a paper at 5 p.m., and you were late 15 minutes, and I said that was the rule, 20% of your grade depended on it. You didn't make the cut, sorry, I have to be fair to everybody, there goes 20% of your grade. What does that rule, as legitimate as it can be, have to do with any one of these outcomes? That's the idea. So in other words, that's why we are talking so much about program learning outcome and institutional learning outcome, so that collectively as departments, as an institution, we can identify those outcomes one after another, leading to some kind of a competency that we know could be a good indicator of what it is that the students can do and how successful they are going to be in workplace. Absolutely, that's what it is. That's the whole effort. So again, Trag.net is going to help you with this. And you know, I don't work for Trag.net, and I kind of like every time I say, you know, that's what they'll do, I feel, you know, awkward. But that it's a tool that I use, and it makes perfect sense. That again, those tools that I showed on the previous slide do exist there, that you can see what are the outcomes for the course. Then for the once you do the alignment of those, you can have the whole map of what it is that the program does. And in turn, from program, you can go to institution. And you do it pretty much hand by field by field, very systematically, until it all aligns together to an institutional learning outcome. And that's the idea. So that again, if courses, even if students who are majoring in science-oriented subjects, they will be good communicators and they will have good writing skills. That's the idea. And those students who have taken courses in history and philosophy and perhaps psychology will know how to use technology. They will have good writing skills and they will be able to communicate with others and solve problems. Does this make sense? Okay. Data informed decision making, I think I already addressed that.
Maybe in the meantime,
it is what it is.
What are some of the changes you've seen that?
Oh, here we go. That's right. And that's
what are some of the changes that have actually
that actually
happened.
Took place? And I have some screenshots. Maybe that way. Once you identify the student learning outcome, you start talking about assessment, you know what happens? Again, your attitude about what it is that students need to know is going to be reflective of the method of assessment or the way you're going to measure it. So what happens is that, again, if you're concerned with making sure that students will list something at the end of the course, then you can give them a multiple choice test, knock yourself out. Here's the answer. However, when it comes to the application of the knowledge and asking your students to come up with something new on the basis of what it is that they've learned in the course, that's a completely different question when it comes to assessment. Because as you can imagine, that's not something that you can perhaps, or you cannot, that you can successfully test with multiple choice tests, right? You can't just ask students, you know, what would you do, and I think that's the example I used earlier, what would you do if you were Winston Churchill during World War II, and then give them a multiple choice test? This wouldn't quite make much sense, because again, it's not only what it is that the students know. It's not only what students know about World War II, it's not only what it is that they know about the role of Winston Churchill in World War II, but it's also about what it is that they know about themselves living now in 2016 and looking at what it is that happened during the war from the perspective of time and their own experience. So speaking of that, because I mentioned that, I would like to draw attention to my slides here, because the types of assessments are going to help you determine the scope and depth of what it is that your students are learning. So what I mean by that is, again, as I mentioned earlier, standardized tests may not be necessarily everything and anything you can always give your students at any given time and expect results. Surveys, well, maybe a better way of looking at this. Performance-based assessments, if you ask students to prepare some kind of a presentation, and what would be a good way to assess a performance-based presentation? Any ideas? How would you assess my performance? Like, can you do it with a multiple choice test?
It's really subjective.
That's exactly right. So in order to be a little bit more impartial and create a norm, you would use something like a rubric or some kind of a, you know, number of statements that will help you. Let's just say used technology, okay? Click an X next to it. And again, when you talk about the institutional outcomes, technology is one of those. We really would like our students to know how to use PowerPoint, how to create presentations with computers, right? So they don't go just up there, hey, I'm not familiar with it, I'm still pressing the buttons. That they know how to react, how to solve problems with technology. So perhaps rubric would tell you how to assess performance-based any kind of a performance that has that's a result of your teaching. I think what would really add most value to it, however, is if you were to devise it together as a department, as a group of people who know the subject, who know what it is that students need to be taking away from the course. So again, we've tracked that. This is a very, very doable exercise, and I just wanted to again go back a couple of slides here. I apologize for the malfunction here, but that's an example of a report that the TrackDot can generate. So you're going to have the course SLO, method of assessment, the result, and actions. See, and this addresses the question that you raised earlier. You're going to say, hey guys, listen, our program depends on this course. We absolutely must make it a prerequisite, and students will not move on in the program unless they do this course. And you know how I know it? Because when I did my assessment of practice and theory in that course, I realized that these SLOs are absolutely vital for the success of the students in the following courses. That's why we align them that way. That's why we have four of them, not five or seven, not two or three. It's got to be four, and the first one has to be here. And the results are right here in this report. Yes?
I'm sorry, is this an individual assessment or assessment based on everyone who teaches in particular?
Oh, well, then again, that's the whole issue of, you know, the discussion of how you approach SLOs. See, that's a different discussion, but I'm glad you asked that question, because over the years, you know, again, the concept of SLOs, you know, let's just say that now we kind of like really turned the corner, I hope, in the discussion, but in the old days, 6 months ago, we were taught, you know, SLOs were considered this, you know, added-on, you know, well, nobody wants to do it kind of an activity. And I think that what needs to be said here is that we are really looking at SLOs as the way to improve on specific skills, therefore the work of the department or the program or the institution. Now, if we think that SLO is something that accrediting body requires of us, then we are going to do the minimal amount of work, or, you know, let's just say we are going to draw a sample, and, you know, 10% of the courses would be enough to assess. If you think, yeah, we shouldn't go to 15, let's just 8%, it's doable. So let's go ahead and do 8%, and then you disaggregate the data, and what happens is that your population next semester changes. So all your sample, whatever you've done, just kind of like goes out the window. It just doesn't make any sense anymore, because you draw another sample and the results are completely different. It's not veterans who are over 30 who are not doing well in chemistry. Now it's the single mothers who are under 25 who are not doing well in history. What are you going to do then? So my advice would be to really, if you're, again, if you're serious about the improvement of the department, you collect the data at every possible option you may possibly have, which means from semester to semester, from year to year, simply because, again, when you sit around and you look each other in the eye, you're going to say, well, how do you know this? Who told you? Well, 8% of the, well, come on, it's 8%, it's 8%. You know, let's go ahead and look what it is that we can do collectively as an institution, rather than just, you know, draw sample after sample because of the reason. Population's changed, that's the one.
So my question is, what we're looking at here is one assessment for one section of music.
Right, so this is music, and again, this is one SLO on top, and the second SLO is at the bottom. One method of assessment is there, and one assessment is here. So this would, you know, if, I don't think it corresponds to it, but let's just say that this is the theory in practice, right? So again, you decide what is the assessment. And if you have 3, 4, 5 sections, let's say, of a course, and you stand by performance, and you stand by portfolio, and you stand by a written essay at the end, well, then that's what it is. So we have three different types of assessments, and you're going to identify them here. And what matters is that the results are in the next column. So you're going to say, okay, my students in this course, as a result of a written assessment, performance 72%, yours are 85 and yours are 92. Well, we got to do something about it. Yes?
This makes me happy. Sure. I want to know the criteria. What class is this? Is it just generally music, or is it
music laboratory? Music 009A.
Which means what?
It's a course. It's a course. I am not a musician, I just pulled it out.
I am.
Okay, well, you know what, then I can give you an email address or even phone number of the music department, you know, chair at Santa College, you can call it.
Because I'm thinking.
But what's the question, really?
Look, it's divided in three.
Okay.
It's theory, which is the technical end.
Okay.
And it's history. Which is really one thing on history and its performance.
Excellent. That's right, so we have three defense SLOs.
And you have to, each one
exactly. That's a very good point. Remember, I think this is the saying that I used with American Sign Language, right? That it's three distinct SLOs that have to do with three distinct competencies. And to be honest, I don't know. There might have been a third SLO on the bottom. I just didn't come up on the screen.
Yeah. So to me, it's kind of like, well.
Yeah. Well, again, that's why you are going to have that report and see right away it generated a question in your mind. That's the idea.
Yeah, but we don't teach necessarily all of those three areas.
It's up to you.
On these SLOs, it looks like it's a performance class.
I am not.
It looks like a performance class.
And I'm not here to tell you shall do this and this and this in the course.
The,
yeah.
So going back to the original point, Lloyd, TrackDad does lend us the power to include multiple section reports. What you're seeing here is just a one-section report.
We don't
have the capacity to include all the sections in there and extract and build other mini reports out of these multiple sections.
And can you incorporate other people's assessment of the same class?
Correct.
Your own assessment?
Sure.
You can extract from multiple sections.
Okay.
That's the idea, because again, as I was saying earlier, if yours, there are three different methods of assessment assessing the same SLO in the same course, then you need to be mindful. And then again, the three of you will get together and you're going to say, okay, you know what? For the sake of our, you know, own sanity, let's go ahead and stick to writing. Or, you know, why don't we just do performance? And then you can start collaborating on this to see what works for you. I'm not going to tell you that you're the winner, or you're not.
I don't argue.
Okay, good. Data collection, I think that's, again, these are just the different types of assessments that are available. Rubrics, portfolio standards, that's, I think I talked about. SurveyMonkey, you're familiar with SurveyMonkey? That's, you know, yeah, that's not a bad tool. Chart that best practices, since we are about the database. Again, we course to program to institutional alignment in track, that's very clear. You print the report at some point. What matters, however, is that you will see. The reason I like Trackdown is because, again, it's very predictable, it's very intuitive, and I tell you, it will not let you just kind of like make mistakes. You may not have method of assessment unless your SLO is identified. You may not have results unless you know what the method of assessment is. You will not go anywhere until the first, you know, first things first kind of thing. It's built on this, on that principle, and it seems to be working just fine. Reporting and document repository, again, as I was saying earlier, all those minutes from meetings or whatever it is that you want, the different types of assessment that you use, you can upload them there, keep them, and 2 years later or whenever, you can just go back and revisit. You know, was that a good idea? Look, this is a sample. This is what we did a couple years ago. Let's look at this differently. Data-driven decision. Luis was asking, what are the results? And I, oh gosh, this is the, I tell you, holy grail of everything that we do. We are kind of like short on time, but let me just say that, I'll just describe it.
I think folks would be okay
if I show a little bit more of a detail.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's look at the data-driven decision-making, that Tableau and Excel, you know, research and planning group is an excellent resource for this. But the bottom line is that there really needs to be quite a bit of discussion about norming, if you could please make a note of that term, norming for testing, or testing norming, and just go to Google and look it up. Because, as I was saying, your way of assessing the course and your way may be quite different. And you are certainly welcome to disagree, and I'm not telling you that you have to do anything. But it would be a good idea for you to sit down and figure out what it is that you are measuring so that the results are consistent and conclusive to the point that when you make a decision based on those results, you're not going to be laughing at yourself, that this really makes a difference. Yeah.
So we have to actually agree. If we're in the same department, we would have to work it out between.
It would be a good idea. It would be
so then if we're on the same page, we're on the,
we're
using the same.
And then what happens, that's right, then what happens is you use Tableau or Excel or I don't know, any kind of a program. Are you familiar with Tableau at all?
Yeah, I'm familiar with the college of the package, but I know.
Okay, well that's right. And the data visualization are just, you know, certain processes that make data jump out at you. And I did create a number. You know what? Maybe when we're having a break, I'll pull up a couple of websites, and when you come back, I'll just show them to you. Okay? So maybe we can do it that way instead of just me taking everybody's time looking for them. So I can do that because again, the bottom line is that when you talk about numbers, especially, you know, people kind of like, you know, okay, enough of this. But when you create some kind of a visualization that will help you see how the numbers behave in a more attractive fashion, I suppose, then people kind of like tend to react better, and that's the idea. Yeah, we could have a discussion about Tableau versus Excel, that's a different story. But I'll show you some of the visualizations after the break. Any questions at this point?
I was hoping we
could
just invest a little bit of time. Can you go back 2 slides
mm-hmm.
To the reports slide? The one with that one.
Uh-huh.
So once we have all these actions, is there any framework at Santa Ana College or from your experience that works to ensure that those actions are not just narrated but implemented? Mm-hmm. And how does that look and track that implementation, the closing the loop,
that's right,
final phase?
Right.
How can we track that? How can we learn about it? And so
how do you make it work? Okay. So the way this works is that, again, we have action, we have resource requests that needs to be implemented in order to address the action, and then you have the follow-up. So those things are, again, have to happen in a sequence in the database for everything to happen. You cannot start working on actions if you don't have anything else before that, right? So I think that's clear. Now what happens is that we have our own Digital system, okay, that's connected to all the finances and everything else. Normally for the departments and for the divisions, this is enough because we print those reports and we bring those to the table saying, you know, look at our SLOs, look at our results, this is what we think we need. And very often, department chairs will highlight here, you know, this is what it's going to cost X number of dollars for this to be implemented. Once we have that information in place, you look at the school calendar basically, because you have to have budgets approved by certain deadlines. So then we have like a cabinet like meeting, you know, when we have the VPs, the deans, and everybody's making those decisions about budgets. And the department, it's not even department chairs, I think it's the deans at that point that take it to the president, and that's when those decisions are made, again, based on the data. So these things all can be generated by TrackDat, and that's the whole idea, that you have step by step, it's a very systematic, very predictable process, and at the end, when it comes to the dollar amounts, you can link those, because again, those are either PDF or Excel. So again, different people look at it differently. PDF will be something that, you know, perhaps for an administrator's reference, but when it comes to actual accounting, if these were the reports that go to accountants, then they would like to be interested in PDFs so that they can extract those numbers and aggregate them, generate them, you know, link them to funding sources and stuff. So that's the idea.
What is your take on weaknesses of TrackDat?
You know what, I don't know if this is their weakness necessarily, maybe it's just my expectation. I would like the data that's entered there, I would like that data to be extracted to create some kind of a visualization in TrackDat. It doesn't do that. I have to use Excel or Tableau to generate those. But then again, when you think about it, okay, Microsoft Word is not PowerPoint, you know? So it's kind of like, you know, so you could do certain things in Word that look like PowerPoint, but you know, PowerPoint is better equipped for presentation purposes. So that's how I look at the product. But that was the only thing that I found as you know, if I were to improve on the product. But then again, you know, they are already there. They have their action point and other things that can be linked to this that do those things. So it's not that bad. It's just a question of what it is that you do. I think that again, those technology oriented tools, no matter how flashy they are, they really need to address the need of your school, of your program. That's where the rubber hits the road, kind of thing. That's you have to have those discussions, and again, with students in mind, looking at SLOs, and then I tell you, the visualization and all these other things, you know, come into play much later, and they will be important. But I think on the basis of a very thorough, very deep understanding of what it is that your institution thus is doing for the students. I think only then you can have those discussions and just say, oh, this visualization is better than the other. Okay?
Thank you for that request. Any other?
You okay? Any questions at this point? Yeah.
Just to clarify.
Sure.
Of course. Do you use individual student level assess, reporting?
Uh-huh.
Is it connected to your student?
Okay, from data, no, we don't. We don't import individual students to track that. No, we have courses. And then again, with the data tools, teachers, individual teachers, if they want to do it, they can enter student data into track that way.
So you do it at the section level?
But we do it at the section level, that's right. Uh-huh. Yep. That's the difference. Again, I don't think when track that was designed initially, the issue of, you know, SLO data, assessment data disaggregation was not on the map. So I think that's why it's not equipped to do that.
So what is your plan to do the equity aggregation or disaggregation?
Well, we have a researcher who does that.
Also, they actually, but then how does it, so if you're not connecting student data, how do you know your population subgroups?
Okay, again, equity and SLO have been historically separate concepts. Only now, because of the ACCGC mandate, they come into play. Again, ACCGC calls for disaggregation of student subpopulations. It doesn't tell you that it has to be equity, but it may as well, maybe. So in other words, okay, so now what we need to do is make sure that we have student learning outcome data aligned with the equity subgroups, and we are home free, at least to the extent that we think we are. More discussion, I suppose, could be had, but again, that's something in the future, about other possible subpopulations that may exist at Santana College that we simply don't pay attention to right now, or we just simply don't know that they are there. But they, those things, that's why we are having those focus group and discussions. So, you
know, where is the, I'm not sure if you know this, but where is the equity data coming from?
Equity data, where does it come from?
Right.
Well, normally, you know, for us, it's data cell, goes into a spreadsheet, and the researcher analyzes it. And she comes up with, you know, with the subpopulations that are impacted. We have actually, we had a research analyst that, who developed our student equity tool online, and that's a live data that really disaggregates semester by semester, and it shows you where the impacted groups are across the board. But it is linked to to DataTel. It has nothing to do with Travda. Again, Travda historically, and again, Travda is a product to address the student learning outcomes assessment and what it is when it comes to program planning. Equity is a different operation. And again, I'm glad you're asking this because again, equity is focused on student achievement as understood by grade, course completion, certificate, transition, things of that nature. Student learning outcomes have to do with student learning as defined by faculty. That's a big difference. And those things do merge. Hopefully they are not going to collide. Yeah.
You probably said it earlier in your lecture, but does the track that information then at some point go to an accreditation committee?
That's the idea. That's the idea because again, this report is just for the course level.
Right.
But then when you go to program to institution, yes, there is a program review component, and again, you will at the end, once you have all the data in place, you can generate a report that instead of having all those, you know, whoever is doing your accreditation work, you know, puts everything in the Word, you know, and has all those documents and then probably, you know, published somewhere on the website. It's a repository of all this information. Okay. So at some point, that's the idea, that you generate a report and you just simply staple it and send it to ACCGC.
Okay.
And you're done. That's the, yeah, as easy as it's possible.
I know we're kind of joking from topic to topic, but one thing that just came to mind is the utilization of SLO facilitators and track that. Can you run through what is it that the SLO facilitators are doing with the track that?
Right. You know, it's really very, very simple. Well, I suppose it is. Again, it has to do with the size of the department. So, as I mentioned earlier, math and
so we have facilitators in all of our divisions.
Right.
Here.
So that's what it is. So those are the people who will be responsible, you know, for engagement of adjuncts, for example. You know, those are the people who will be responsible for making sure that assessment data is submitted, you know, to one of them by a certain deadline. You know, Santa Ana is a huge college, and I'm sure you're not small here either. You know, so it's really difficult for one person to make sure that all the wheels are turning at all times, you know, throughout the semester, and that's why those facilitators help with that. So, and those actually math, I think they are called subject or area experts of sorts. And they will make sure that, you know, except, you know, let's just say the level of, you know, math 101 or 105 or whatever those designations happen to be, that they are going to be responsible for making sure that the data for the course is collected in a timely fashion so that we can have a discussion the following semester. That's the idea. But articulation of SLOs and method of assessment is part of the discussion. That's very crucial that, you know, those people are involved in this.
Okay.
If I could please have your have your attention on the board. I will very quickly share a couple of links that I have, because those are the data visualizations that I have created with Tableau. But I tell you, you know, again, the Tableau is a very, very flashy piece of software that costs a lot of money and takes a lot of training. And I can share from my experience. A couple of years ago, I actually did design visualizations that I show you. It's just that, and I tell you, it took me about 3-4 months to sit there and figure out how to do it. And Tableau will give you a training, but it's very, you know, okay, maybe even if it's focused, it's usually very expensive, and you really need to use the software pretty much every day to kind of like make sense out of it. So what I did is I went through their tutorials, I went to YouTube videos and whatnot, and I talked to colleagues who are masters in it, and I created those visualizations. And I tell you, 3-4 months later, I did this? How did I get there? Oh gosh, I mean, this is so complex, you know? It just seems like I had to kind of like learn everything all over again. So that's the danger that, you know, if you have someone who is responsible for Tableau or any other such product, please make sure that it's expanded, the role of that you don't have just one person that will go through the training, and you spend thousands of dollars on doing that, and then, you know, 6 months later, the person says, well, I got a better things to do in my life, and they leave, and you're stuck with all this information that's there, and nobody to follow up with. So that's just my lesson. But what it can do is that, you know, these are, this was the writing performance for different ESL courses. And in this case here, we have a clarity and content was important for the teachers. So we have the beginning three on the top, the academic beginning three course on the very top. And again, the content and clarity were important. Those were the things that were measured. And now if you like, you can just click on the visualization, and it will show you just clarity, how students perform on clarity through all these different courses. Oh, sorry, it's cut off. It's just that, see, it will tell you that, you know, for the since this was writing, that's right, this was the writing course. And these are all ESL courses there, so academic classes on top performed at, you know, 45%, then the beginning literacy 38%, but then the lowest course were actually in writing classes. So then the department sat around saying, okay, hold on, what exactly are we looking at? Writing courses, students perform the worst of them all? I mean, this is like, you know, what? Beginning literacy does better on writing assessment than the writing course itself? Doesn't make any sense at all. What's the problem? Different courses, different types of assessment. There are completely different expectations for beginning literacy course versus the writing course itself. That's the reason. But see, you wouldn't know it without looking at the data, looking at this information. So now the department can sit around and say, okay, absolutely, couldn't agree more. I mean, for a writing course, for students in a writing course to be performing at 23%, that's just, you know, ludicrous. I mean, it just doesn't make any sense. That's not reality. Our students do much better than that. Then we have the two courses, writing A and writing B. In writing A, 23%, writing B, 47%. Still way, way, way below what we think should be our passing rate of, you know, 75% or so. But at least we can have a discussion. So we sit around, we look at this data, and then we go course by course by course by course, and that's what Tribelab is supposed to do for you. That's the idea. So again, that's just an example of the data visualization, and it was similar things that you could create. You know, again, Tableau will do it for you. Here you can just have a focus on one year, and this just kind of like, you know, gives you an idea of how students did from year to year. We have, this was fall 2010. Oh, what's important is that this is just a trick of the trade. When you compare results, you really should go from semester, not from fall to spring, but rather fall to fall and spring to spring, because, you know, that's populations change and students show up to school different.
I'm sorry, can you say that again?
Make may make a difference. Of course, when you compare the data from semester to semester, you shouldn't look at fall versus spring performance because the student populations may differ. What you may want to look at is fall to fall to fall. So let's just say you have 3 years worth of data, and you're going to look at fall 2011, fall 2012, fall 2013, and then you can do spring 2012, 2013, spring 2014, instead of comparing fall to spring. Because, and I mean, you can try it, you will see what happens. Normally, students who come to school in the fall, for the most part, are more motivated than the ones that are there in the spring. Fall semester is kind of like, you know, gone hall, everybody goes back to school. Spring is for those students who are normally kind of like lingering there because they have a motivation or because they have to. And if they have to, then it's, you know, it's quite different from your own, you know, motivation that drives you to attend school in September. But that's, again, those are the and you perhaps may come up with completely different interpretations of those comparisons, but it's just, you know, one of those things that you probably learn to pay attention to as you look at the data, as you analyze it from semester to semester. Now, at the end, there's nothing wrong with aggregating everything and looking at, you know, performance from year to year. You can obviously, you know, do that. Just make sure that you always have same intervals and same time frames.